Hi everybody, this is the St. Philip's College Stats final exam review for Math 1442. Let's get right into it. There are 30 questions in this review. I'm going to try to do each one of them. So let's look at number one. It says for the given frequency distribution, find the class boundaries and the midpoints. So first we're going to find the class boundaries. And that's very easy. If you look at our class over here, the class boundaries are the exact same thing that you see there, except 0.5 less and 0.5 more. So we would have what's 42 minus 0.5? You would get 41.5. And then what's 45 plus 0.5? You'd get 45.5. So it's just subtracting a half and adding a half to the class that we have there. Now, what's good about this also, the boundaries, is whatever this 45.5 you have here, it's going to start off the same number. 45.5 is going to start off down here, and we're going to keep on going. So more, a half more than 49 over here, 49.5. And you can keep on going. A half more than 53, 53.5. A half more than 57, 57.5. 61.5, 65.5, and 69.5. Okay, and now we can just fill these in. You can do a half less than this, or you can do the previous upper limit of the previous class. So 49.5 goes here, 53. Do you see I'm just using this 53.5? I'm using this 57.5, 61.5, 65.5. And these are our class boundaries. So to find our class boundaries, you just do a half less and a half more. Pretty much, since we're using whole digits there, you're going to use a half of that particular digit. If we were using a decimal place, you would use half of that particular decimal place. Oh, and there's more we wanted to do here. What are the midpoints? So midpoints are kind of easy. To do the midpoints, add the lower limit and the add your lower limit and upper limit of your class boundary and divide by 2. So on the left-hand side there, I'm going to add those two together. 41.5 plus 45.5. So do you notice I'm adding these two together and I get 87 divided by 2. So I add the two together and divide by 2 and my midpoint is 43.5. And I could do with the next one, 45.5 plus 49.5 divided by 2, add them together and divide by 2 and I get 47. I'm going to do the next one, 49.5 plus 53.5, and I am going to divide that by 2, and I get 51.5. Now, if you noticed, we're adding 4 to each of these previous midpoints, so you can just add 4 to this next midpoint, and you get 55.5. You can add 4 and you get 59.5. You add 4, you get 63.5. And you add 4, you get 67. And that's how you get your midpoints. You add these two together and then divide it by two. All right, second question. It says, ages of the president, at the time of the death, use this data to find the upper and lower limits of a frequency distribution. So, on the previous problem, our classes are our upper and lower limits. So these, our classes where were our upper and lower limits. So we want to find this out for the next problem. We want to find our upper and lower limits for this particular problem. Well, the way you do that is look at your highest piece of data and your lowest piece of data. So if you look at all these pieces of data, the highest piece of data is 98. And my lowest piece of data, I believe, is 51. So on your calculator, 98 minus 51. Let's see what 98 minus 51 is. 47. So we have, you know, the between our upper, our highest piece of data and our lowest piece of data is 47. It says we want to break this down into eight classes. We want eight separate classes. In the previous problem, let's see how many classes we had. We had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 classes. Well, in the problem we're about to do, we want 8 classes. So we find our range. By the way, this was our range, right? Highest piece of data minus the lowest piece of data, 47, and we're going to divide that by 8. Let's do that. Divide it by 8, and I get 5.875. Well, this is going to be our class width. But what you always have to do is just always round this number up. So if I round it up to the next digit, it's 6. So this is going to be our class width. 6 is our class width. So if we start with our lowest piece of data now. If we start with our lowest piece of data, which is 51. Let me bring this down a little if I can. If I start with our lowest piece of data, 51, my class width has to be 6. That means 6 possible digits need to go between this. So if I just write this on the side here, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, and 56. Do you see I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I have 6 consecutive digits. So our lower boundary is 51 for this class, and our upper boundary is 56 for this class. So that's our first class, 51 through 56. This has a class width of 6. You don't subtract those two. You find out how many data, pieces of the data could go between there if you're looking at whole numbers, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, and 56. I want to go back up to the top and show you now our class, class here. We have 42 to 45. Then you start the next one at the next digit, 46. And you're going to go to the next one, and then you go to the next number. So it's not the same as the boundaries over here where this boundary was the same here. Our classes are different. Okay, so our classes are different when we're looking at our class with their with in it. So my next piece of data will be one more than 56, which will be 57. And I need to get six pieces of data in here. One way of doing it, if you see, if you have 51, we added 5 and got 56. If I add 5 to 57, I get 62. And if you look once again, you have six pieces of data, possible six pieces of data in there, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, and 62. If you count them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's why our class with this, a 6. Then we go to the next number, 63, add 5, and you get 68. Go to the next number, and I'm going to put it up here, sorry. 69, add 5, and you get 74. 75, add 5, and you get 80. 81, add 5, you get 86. 87, add 5, you get 92. 90, I'm going to put it up here, 93, add 5, and you get 98. If you look now, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 classes. Our highest piece of data is 98, so it's all going to fill with, you know, all our data is going to fill within that these boundaries. And so that's how you find your upper and lower limits for your classes. Alrighty, let's look at question 3. It says display the data in a stem leaf plot. So if we look at our data, this first dot represents 73. Then here's 75. This is 76, 76. In our stem leaf plot, so we start off with the 70s, then the 80s, the 90s. So let's look at how we're going to do our stem leaf. We have 70s, we have 80s, and we have 90s. And then we draw a line, and then we represent each dot on the graph. So this first dot, if we look at it, is 73. So we put a 3 here. This is 73, the way you would do it on the stem leaf. That's not 73. There's 75. One to the left of it should 74. I'm sorry. It looked like 73 to me. 74. Okay, so let me get rid of the other dot there, too. All right, 7, 8. And 9. So the first dot is 74. Then I have two dots at 76. 76, 76. Do you see this is the whole number, the tens column, and these are all the ones column. You have to represent each dot. There's a dot at 79. And then there's 1, 2, 3, 4 dots at 80. There's 180, 280, 380, 480. I see a 81, 82, 83, 2 84s, 85s, 4 85s, 2, 3, 4 85s, and 2 89s. Then we're in the 90s. I have 2 in the 90s. There's a 93, 94, 93, 94, 95, 96, and if you count that over this one, that's a 98. And this is the stem leaf. You have the tens column in this case, and then you have the ones column, and each piece of data is represented. So it's kind of like distribution. This is 74. This is 76. So this is 76. This 9 is really 79. So that's how they're represented. Question 4. So it says state whether this distribution is symmetrical, and pretty much if something is symmetrical, it kind of looks like a normal curve. Sorry, my pen's acting up a little bit. So this is what a symmetric, oh, maybe not that great, not that there, this is a symmetrical curve, kind of, where half the data is on one side, half the data is on the other. So if we look at this curve, kind of look at it sideways, and if you try to draw it, you notice my pen acts up, but if you try to draw this thing, it's not symmetrical. It's the graph is moved over. The graph, I mean, if you look at it and bring it, just flip it, the graph is moved over to the right. Most of the data is moved over to the right. So that is called left skewered, where the left side has less data than the right side. So that is called left skewered. Okay. My pen is really acting up. Number 5, what is the weighted mean? So weighted mean is very similar to what we have our grade in this class. So let's look at this. I'm running out of room. I think I'm gonna lower this a little and write it above it. There we go. So it says here, what is the weighted mean? It says you have 5 sources for your grade. First, you have your tests average, and that's 50% of your grade. I'm gonna write the decimal equivalent, 0.5. Then you have your midterm. And that's 15% of your grade, 0.15. Your final is where 20%, 0.20. 10% for your lab work. Lab is 10%. And then you have homework where it's 5% of your grade. And if you add all this up, it should equal 100%. 65, 75, 85, 95, 100. Now the grade for each of these, your test average was 86. So we're going to multiply 86 times the percent that it's worth for the class, 50%. Midterms 96. You have a 96 average. The final, you have an 82. 98 on the lab and 100 on the homework. So what you want to do is multiply all of these and then add them up. So you're going to do, so I'm going to multiply them all and then add them up straight on my calculator. 0.50 times 86 plus 0.15 times 96 plus 0.20 times 82 plus 0.10 times 98 plus 0.05 times 100 hit equals, and it all adds up to the weighted mean, which is 88.6. So this would be your final grade at the end of the course. So we did each individual one. I didn't post them what I got for each because I just let my calculator keep on doing it. I multiplied these two, then I multiplied these two, then I add 0.15 hit plus and plus in your calculator, you should get 88.6. Or you can do each individual one. Put your answer here, 0.15 times 96, 0.20 times 82. Put the answers here and then add them all up, and you should get 88.6. All right. Okay, so number six, we're going to use our calculator. Here we go. What you need to do first, we're going to find the correlation coefficient. This is what we have here is we have data, and each one of these is a coordinate on a graph. The 1.6 is the x value, the 4.82 is the y value. So these are coordinates on a graph. And if we draw this on a graph, there would be just a whole bunch of dots on a graph. Actually, we're going to do that. We'll do that. And then we want to draw a line in there to see the best fit line, how the line would look on our graph. So first, I want to go on my calculator. I want to go to Stat. On my calculator, hit the Stat button. And click on number one, edit. So first I clicked on the stat button here. And then I clicked number one, edit. And I'm going to type in all the x values. If you notice, I already did at 1.6 on the left-hand side. And then all the y values in list two. All the x values in list one. And then I typed in all the y values in list two. Okay, so once you do that, I'll give you a second. To find the correlation coefficient, the symbol for that is R. The symbol for that is R. So to find the actual correlation coefficient, go to Stat. No, so first we did Stat, and then we went to number one, and we typed in list one and list two. We typed in all our data into list one and two. Now I want you to go to Stat again. Stat again. And go to Calculate. It's the second button over, so we went to Stat, and then we moved it over from Edit to Calculate, and then we're going to scroll down to number four. Scroll down to number four, Linear Regression. And if you hit Enter, it'll look like this, and then hit Enter one more time. And R is 0.8824. Do you see down at the bottom, R is 0.8824. 0.8824. And that is the correlation coefficient that we're looking for. Now, if you don't have those two bottom ones, the R square and the R on your calculator, if you don't have those, this no big deal. I'm going to show you how to get it. What you have to do is turn your diagnostic on before you can get that. So on your calculator, we're going to turn our diagnostic on. So on your calculator, you're going to hit second calculate. So hit your second button up here. And then second calculate. Sorry, second catalog, the zero button. Hit second and then catalog, the zero button, second catalog. And then scroll all the way down till you see diagnostic on. They're in alphabetical order. Just scroll down till you see diagnostic on. Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Keep going, and there's diagnostic off and diagnostic on. Put the arrow on diagnostic on. Hit enter. Hit enter. And your diagnostic is on. It says it's done. Now, if you do that, if you didn't get the R before, now if you go to stat, calculate number four, linear regression, you will get it now. 0.8824. And if you look at the here, it tells you kind of how to do it. Yeah, it does tell you how to do it. All right, next question. Number seven. Based on the data, bell-shaped curve, our mean is 280, our average is 280, our standard deviation is 65. Use the empirical rule. What is the approximation for this? What is the approximation for percentage of women with these boundaries here? Well, it says if you look at a normal curve, it says it's a bell-shaped curve. So let me try to draw a bell-shaped curve. There we go. It says the average. The average is dead center in a normal curve, in a bell-shaped curve. Our mean is 280, so I'm putting 280 here. And as you get away from the mean, you're getting so many standard deviations away from the mean. So it says one standard deviation is 65. So if I add 65, one standard deviation, if I add 65 to 280, our mean, if I add 65 to that, I get 345. That's one standard deviation away. If I subtract 65, I'm one standard deviation this way. If I subtract 65 from 280, I get 215. So do you see one standard deviation on both sides of 280 is between 215 and 345? That's what they're asking. Use the empirical rule. What is the approximation? Well, the approximation is that we're one standard deviation away from the mean. And the empirical rule says if you're one standard deviation away from the mean, 68% of the data falls into this category. So the answer is 68%. Now, if they were to ask two standard deviations from the mean, you would add 65 to this and you would get, 245 plus 65. Sorry for the calculator there. I mean, so 345 plus 65 here, and you would get 410. And then I would subtract 65 here to get another standard deviation, and I get 150. So between 150 and 410, 150 and 410, there's two standard deviations. And in the empirical rule it says two standard deviations, you would have 95% of the data, 95%. So they in this problem they were just asking one standard deviation. You know, they just asked what's between 215 and 345. That's one standard deviation. But if you had two standard deviations, it'd be 95% of the data. Three standard deviations would be 99.7% of our data. Question 8. Find the sample mean using the rounding rule. Well, we're going to go into our calculator, and find the sample mean for this. First, we want to find the midpoint of each of these scores. I'm going to write down the midpoints here. Okay, so for number 8, what we need to do is find the medians or the middle of each of these scores. We want to find the middle point of each of those, the median. So what we're going to do is add them up. And divide by 2. So let's add both of these up. 478 plus 504 and divide it by 2 and you should get 491. Next one, 505 plus 531. Hit enter and then divide it by 2. 518. So don't hit divided by 2 before you hit enter. You have to add those two and then divide it by 2. If you don't add them first, you'll get the wrong answer. 532 plus 558. Hit enter, which gives you what it adds up to, then divided by 2. 545. And if you notice, they're increasing by 27 each time. This would be 572. And this would be 599. So what we need to do now is put these in lists. Put this in list 2 and all your medians in list 1. So frequencies in list 2, medians in list 1. So go to stat, edit number 1. So we're going to stat number 1, edit. And we're going to enter in list 1 and list 2. List 1. Is going to be my medians, 491, enter, 518, enter, 545, enter, 572, enter, 599, enter. List 2 will be 4, 6, 2, 2, and 1. And your list 1 and 2 should look like this. Don't worry about my list 3. We're just talking about list 1 and 2 right now. So we're just going to do a stats bar 1. Stat calculate. So to find our sample mean, we're going to stat. Move over to calculate. And then we're going to do a number 1. Var stats. And don't forget, we're doing list 1, and then the frequency is going to be list 2. And if you need to know how to type in list 2 into your calculator, it's second number 2. Second number 2. So you go to second 2 to put list 2 in there. And if we look at our average for this problem, we get 531.5 from our calculator. Very first one. All right, question 9. Find the coefficient of variation for question 9. So, coefficient of variation, you got to know the formula. So, C var, coefficient of variation, equals the sample standard deviation, I'm going to put SD so you know, divided by the sample average. So we have to type in all this data into a list, all this data into a list. You can call this list 1 if you want to call this list 2, whatever you want to do. We're going to type, I'm just going to do one list. I'm going to do the Obama list. Type all that into a list. So I'm going to stat, number 1, edit. And I typed it all into list number 3. But you want to type yours into list 1 there. So I typed it into list 3, but you type all your all these numbers into list 1. And just to stat calculate 1 var. And if you have list 2 in there right now, make sure that list 2 gets deleted for frequency. Just clear that. Because you're only looking at list 1. So if you have list 2 with if you have that frequency with list 2 in there, go to that and clear it. Just go to that and hit clear. You don't want list 2 in that frequency line because we're only looking at list 1 here. Stat clacks. Stat 1 var, and I hit L1. And our sample standard deviation is 3's stat calculate list 3 for me. So mine's just a little different because I had it all preset up for you us already. So if you look at sample standard deviation, it says 523.209 divided by X bar, which is 653.866. Seems like this, there it goes. It takes a little harder to focus. So do you see how the sample standard deviation, the S with the X? S with the X is sample standard deviation. The sigma with the X is the population standard deviation. You want to get sample standard deviation. The SX on the calculator. Divided by the X bar. And that'll give your coefficient of variation. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to do 523.209 divided by 653.8666. And I get, when I punch these two into the calculator, I get 0.80017. In other words, I get 80%. So you're going to do the same thing with McCain. Number 10, we want the 5-number summary, and we want the IQR. It says 5-number summary and the interquartile range. 5-number summary is your minimum value, your Q1, your Q2, also known as the median, Q3, and your max value. So this is the 5-number summary. So I'm going to type all this data in into my list. Put it in list 1. It's so much easier for you guys when you do that. I have it preset up. So I've put it into my list four, but 60, 70, 85, blah, 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 blah. I have all that in my list. And I want to know the five number summary. So first, put in list. Then we're going to go to same as we've been doing. I mean, this is stat, calculate, one vars. Stat, calculate, one vars, stats. And you hit enter, and I put your list one. Mine's in list four. And scroll down. So now you have to scroll down. And do, 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 do. And if you notice, I scroll down and it tells me my minimum, my maximum, Q1, median, and Q3. So my minimum value is 40. The minimum data is 40. Q1 is 50. Q2, which is also the median, is 80. Q3 is 100. And our max value is 115. So there's one more thing we need to find, the IQR, the inner quartile range. Inner quartile range is Q3 minus Q1. Q3 is 100 minus Q1, which is 50. So the inner quartile range, 100 minus 50 is 50. This is the five number summary. And here's the inner quartile range, Q3 minus Q1. All right. Okay, number 11. The monthly bill in a city has a mean. Mean equals 70. Standard deviation equals 8. Find the z-score. Well, the formula for the z-score is x minus the mean divided by the standard deviation. And it says find the z-score corresponding to utility of $71 and explain what you conclude. Of $71, that's our x value, minus our mean, which is 70, divided by the standard deviation, which is 8. So we're just finding the z-score. You put this in your calculator. 71 minus 70 is 1. 1 over 8. It says round it to the hundredths place value, so you put this in your calculator and you get 0.125. Hundredths is two decimal places. I look to the right, five or more, so I'm going to add one to the underlying number. So rounded to the nearest hundredth, the hundredths is the second place value to the right, hundredths. So the answer is 0.13. And it's positive, so it's above the mean. Question 12. Identify any possible outliers. So what they want, there's 27 pieces of data, and identify any possible outliers. Well, let me give you the outlier formula. The outlier formula is Q1 minus 1.5 the IQR, or between that, or Q3 plus 1.5 times the IQR. So if it's above this number or below this number, it's an outlier. It's an outlier. It's a piece of data that doesn't belong there. There's probably something wrong with it. So I'm going to type all this data into my calculator. And I got the right calculator this time. I'm using the right calculator. So I typed it in all in the list one. And we are going to do what we did for the five-number summary. So we're going to do the five-number summary for here. We're going to do min, Q1, Q2, which is the median, Q3, and the max. In reality, I remember IQR was Q3 minus Q1. So all I need to find really in the five-number summary is Q3 minus Q1. So I go to stat, calculate, 1 vars, and you see I have list 1 in my list, and frequency list, I don't have anything. You shouldn't have anything there. Hit enter, 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 calculate. Scroll down, and your five-number summary is there. My Q1 is 660, and my Q3 is 4749.5. I'm going to subtract those two. 4749.5 minus 660. And I get 4089.5. That's my IQR. So 1.5 times the IQR. This is my IQR. Remember, here's my formula. So Q1 is 660. 660 minus 1.5 times the IQR, and IQR is 4089.5. So if you put that on your calculator, it's 660 minus 1.5 times 4089.5. You get this huge negative number, negative 5,474. -5,474. Well, we don't have any negative numbers. So there's no outlier on the low side. So now if we look on the high side, Q3 was 4749.5 times 1.5 times the IQR, 4089.5. So I put that in my calculator, 4749.5 times 1.5, oh, I'm sorry, not times, plus 1.5 times 4089.5. Plus 1.5 times the IQR. And I get 10,883. So, if we have any numbers larger than 10,000, then it's an outlier. And we do. Here is one that is larger than 10,000. And I think we have one more. There it is, 11,000. These are the two outliers. Pieces of data that really don't fit in with all the rest. Okay, so that's number 12. Number 13, it says, find the probability that an electrical engineer, here are the electrical engineers, find the probability that an electrical engineer is chosen, given that the gender is male. So here are the males. So we're looking at this guy. It's given that they're male. So first we have to add up all the males. I'm going to add them all up. 9691 plus 4997 plus 6064. So if we look at all the males, we have 20,752. It says find the probability that this person we choose is an electrical engineer, knowing, given that we already know he's male. So we want to pick out of these people, this many people is electrical engineer out of all the males. So we put that in our calculator. 4997 divided by 20,752. 0.2407. And round it to the nearest thousandth. Thousandth is three decimal places. Look to the right. Since it's five or more, you add one. So you get 0.241. There's our answer. Find the probability electrical engineer that this person is electrical engineer giving them, knowing that they're a male. So first we had to figure out how many males we had, and we had 4,997 electrical engineers that were male. Number 14. Okay, a card is drawn from standard deck. Find the probability the card is a face card. So first of all, how many face cards are there in a deck? We know there's 52 cards in a deck. Face cards are Jack, Queen, and King. And we have four of each, right? Each card is a diamond, a heart, a spade, or a club. So we have 12 face cards in the deck of cards. Find the probability that the card is a face card. There are 12 face cards, or a red card. Well, there are half the cards are red. All the diamonds and the hearts are red. So half the cards are red. 52 cards. There are 26 red cards. Okay? So there are 12 face cards and 26 red cards. However, if you look at some of the face cards, some of the face cards are red. Half of them. So six of the face cards are red. Right? The Jack of Diamonds, the Jack of Hearts, the Queen of Diamonds, the Queen of Hearts, the King of Diamonds, and the King of Hearts. Six are red. Well, we're supposed to be adding these up, 12 face cards plus 26 red. The thing is, we added six cards twice, right? The face cards are red. The red cards, the red face cards, we added them twice right here with this 26. So since I've added it twice, you have to subtract 6 from this. So 12 plus 26 minus the 6. And if you look at this, there are 32 possible cards to pick from. A card is drawn from a standard deck. Find the probability of getting a face card or red. Well, there are 32 face cards and red cards combined. There are six face that are black, and there are 26 red cards for a total of 32 cards out of 52. So this is the probability of getting a face card and a red card. We had to subtract 6 because we counted the red face cards here, and we counted the red face cards here. So we had to subtract one set of them. And that's the probability of face card or red, the formula for that is the probability of face plus the probability of red minus the probability of face and red, because you can't count the cards twice. You know, they overlap each other. So our answer is 32 divided by 52. And if you reduce that, they both divide by 4. I get 8 over 13. So there's a fractional equivalent, 8 over 13. If you look at the decimal equivalent to this, depending on what they're asking for in multiple choice, 0.61 something, yeah, 0.615. So just depending on if they want the fraction or they want the decimal equivalent. All right, moving on. 15. Forty-three cars started the Daytona 500. So there are 43 cars. How many ways can cars finish first, second, and third? Would you say, so does order matter? Well, you let me know. Yes, order matters because I want to come in first. So first, second, and third. If you have three cars, if you pick three cars, the order matters. Which one came in first, which one came in second, and which one came in third. So the order does matter. My question to you is, how many possible cars could come in first place? How many possible cars, well, if there are 43 cars in a race, 43 cars could come in first, you know, one of these 43 cards could come in first place. So if somebody comes in first place, how many cars are left to come in second place? 42. And if one car comes in first, one car comes in second out of the 43, how many cars are left to come in third place? Well, there would be 41 cars left. Well, to find out how many possible ways of finishing first, second, and third with 43 cars, this is all you do. 43 times 42 times 41, and you get 74,000 different ways. 74,000. 046. How are we going to do this? I mean, other than this, is there another way of doing this? I just looking to make my calculator, make sure we are okay. We know, permutations are when the order matters. Yes, the order matters. So we could also do this same problem 43 ways, 43 cars. We're going to pick three of them where the order matters. So we're going to plug this into our calculator. So let me grab my actual camera and show you how we're going to type this into our calculator. So first I'm going to type in 43. Then I'm going to go to math and arrow over to probability and go down the number 2. So I clicked on... math. First I clicked on 43, then I clicked on math, arrow over to probability, And then we're going to go to number two, which is permutation. NPR. Hit enter. So we have 43, three ways. When you hit enter again, we get the same answer we just did, 40, 74,000, and 46. So picking three winners out of 43, where order matters. First, second, and third place, the order does matter. Alrighty, let's go to the next problem. Okay, the state transportation plans to develop a new section of highway and receive 16 bids. There are 16 bids. The state plans to hire four. They're going to hire four companies. How many different combinations? And they even tell you this is a combination. Is the order important? They're going to hire four companies. Does it matter if you got hired as the number one or the number four? No, it doesn't matter. They don't say number one's getting paid more or anything. So they're going to hire four companies. There are 16 companies. The order doesn't matter that you get hired. You're just hired. So we're using combination. It tells us we're using a combination. So on our calculator, we're going to do 16 combination 4. Just like we just did, we are going to go through our calculator and do 16 combination 4. So first, we're going to type in 16. Then we're going to go to math. Arrow over to probability, just like we did. Scroll down to combination, which is number 3. How many ways can we hire four companies out of 16? And the answer is 1820. 1,820. Is the order important? No. If you get hired, you get hired. That's the bottom line. You're not getting paid. It doesn't say one company gets paid more than the other. Okay, so number 17, a lot of 1,000 components contain 250 defective. So there's 1,000 parts and 250 are bad. So the probability that you have a bad part, right, is 250 out of 1,000. It tells you right there. The probability that you have a bad part is 250 out of 1,000. Two components are drawn. You're gonna get two components. Two components are drawn and tested. Let A be the event that the first component is drawn is defective, and B be the event that the second component is drawn and defective. What's the probability that B and A that getting the first component bad and the second component bad? What's the probability of getting the first component bad and the second component bad? Well, the probability of getting a bad component on the first one is 250 out of 1,000. It doesn't say they're put back in or anything. So the next probability is 249. There's only 249 bad ones left. So you have 249 out of 999 chance. Because one was taken out already. So let's put this in our calculator, 250 divided by 1,000. times 249 divided by 999. And on my calculator, when I put all this in, I get 0.0623. Round to the thousandths place value. This is the thousandths. Since that's four or less, we keep it at 0.062. That's it. Number 18. Compute the mean, standard deviation, and variance of the discrete random variable. Very simple problem. It's similar to the expected value. We're going to put all this in list one. We're going to put all this in list two. Actually, I'm going to go backwards. I'm sorry. I'm going to put all this in list two. And all this in list one. I want to always put the frequency. This is even though it doesn't look like a frequency, it doesn't. I don't think it matters which list you put it in. I'm going to put the bottom in list one and the top in list two. It shouldn't matter either way. It really shouldn't matter either way. So let's just do it like that. List one and list two. It really shouldn't matter. So the top I'm putting in list one. All these numbers go into list one, and then the bottom numbers go into list two. Okay, so list one and list two. So in list one, stat, edit one, go up to list one and clear it. I go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. In list two, I'm putting 0.05, 0.69, 0.16, 0.08, and 0.02. So I have everything in my lists. And I just do a standard stat calculate 1 bar. Make sure you have your list one in there and your list two in the frequency list. You should be okay. Hit calculate. Don't forget, how do you get list two in there again? You hit second number two. Second number two. Number two, the blue thing says list. Hit calculate. And if you look at, it's asking for the computed mean, you get 1.33. Standard deviation, if you know, there's no sample standard deviation, it's just a standard deviation. 0.775. What else are they asking for? And variance. Oh, so variance is standard deviation squared. You won't see this on your calculator. You just had to put 0.775 and square that on your calculator. 0.775 raised to the second power. So you're going to square your 0.775 and square it, and you get 0.6006. And this is your variance. This is your standard deviation. A student is taking an 18-question test. Four choices for each question, so that means we have A, B, C, D. If I just pick a number at random, do you see I have a 25% chance of getting it correct? Right? One out of four. Well, one out of four, there are four answers. If I just pick A, I have a 1/4 chance, 0.25, of getting the answer correct. Find the probability of guessing exactly 7 out of 8 correct. So we're going to use the binomial distribution here. The probability of exactly 7 out of 8. So we're using binome dist. Binome dist. The probability is 0.25 of getting one correct. We want to know the probability of getting 7 out of 8. This is how much we had total, and this is how much what we have for X. And it's going to be exact. So we're going, since it's exact, we're going to binome dist PDF. We want to know X is exactly 7, not greater than or less than. We want to know exactly 7. So here, so we're finally going to do something different. We're on our calculator, we're hitting second vars. Calculator. We're going to second button. And then the vars. Second vars, which is really distribution. And we're going to scroll down all the way down till we see binomial PDF. Scroll down to binome PDF. PDF is equals. CDF is when it's less than or greater than. So I'm going binomial PDF. Okay, so this is what I end up with when I hit binomial PDF. Well, let me show you what I did. Let me get there first. So we're going to second vars and scrolling all the way down till we find binomial PDF, which is A. Hit enter. The number of trials, there are 8 total, right? It says, there are 18 questions, not 8. I wrote 8. There are 18 questions. So the number of trials are 18. Our probability of getting an answer correct is 0.25. And we want to know getting exactly 7 correct. There are 18 total questions, 25% to get one correct, and we want to know the probability of getting exactly 7 right. Hit enter, and it's going to put it in this form. If you have the old calculator, you have to put it in this form. And then the answer is 0.0820. The probability is 0.0820. And if it says round to the thousandths place value, there's a thousandths, so it's 0.082. All right. Number 20. Okay, so this is going to be a little bit harder. This is one you got to think about. There are 20 questions, 20 true or false. So N is 20. Find the probability that there is at least 3 correct answers. At least 3. X is greater than or equal to 3. That's at least 3, right? 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 or 8, all the way up to 20. 3, 4, 5, 6, blah, 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 18, 19, 20. We want to know what's the probability of getting any one of these amounts correct. Well, the probability of getting a correct answer is 50% because it's true or false. You got to have 50-50 choice. So the probability is 50% of getting it correct. We want to know the probability of X is greater than or equal to 3. Okay, so if I go to binomial distribution, second vars, if you notice, it doesn't say less than or greater than. And we have to use this time, by the way, we have to use binome CDF. PDF was for equals. CDF is for greater than or less than. Now, there's something you got to know. Our calculator will only do less than or equal to. Our calculator will only do less than or equal to. For binomial CDF, our calculator will only do X is less than or equal to some number. By the way, there are other numbers that we could have got right, right? We want to know the probability of at least three right. You know, you could get three right, four right, five right, but you could get two right, one right, or zero right. And don't forget, probability adds up to one. So the way to do this problem, since we can't do three or more, we can't do more than three or equal to three because our calculator will only do less. We have to find this probability right here. We have to find the probability of less than two. We want to find the probability that X is less than or equal to two. That would be 2, 1, or 0. If we can find this probability, we know the entire probability is 1 when you add it all up. So we could just do 1 minus the probability of X is less than or equal to 2. So on my calculator, I am going to do 1 minus the probability that X is less than or equal to 2. So here's how I'm going to type it on my calculator. The number of trials, we already said a student is guessing out of 20 questions. The number of trials is 20. The probability of getting a question correct is 0.5. We want to do less than or equal to 2. Don't forget, we're doing CDF. So CDF is always less than 2. If I was in PDF right now, it would only do X equals 2. But since I'm in CDF, binomial CDF, it's doing 2 or less. So it's going less than or equal to 2. Hit paste. Hit enter. Hit enter. So it's a very small number. So I'm going to do this one more time. I'm sorry. I wanted to show you how we're going to do it. What I have written down is 1 minus the probability of less than or equal to 2. So 1 minus second vars find binomial CDF and then enter the data. Trials is 20, probability is 0.5, value is 2. Hit enter, enter. Do you see? I typed in 1 minus. I typed in 1 minus the binomial. So I just put 1 minus and then I did the binomial distribution. And the answer is 0.9997. .99979, which rounded to 4 decimal places is .9998. Okay, I think I'm going to take a little break now and I'll be back in a little bit. Okay, now we're on question number 21. 21, if 60% of all women, so the probability, 60% of all women are employed outside, so the probability that you're a woman and employed outside is 0.60. Find the probability that in a sample of 20 women, N equals 20, at most, 5 are employed outside the home. So at most, that means 5 is the most. That means, and 5 is included, at most 5. So X is less than or equal to 5, right? At most 5, you can say 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and so on. At most 5. That means 5 is the most. So x is less than or equal to 5. And this is a binomial distribution because you're either employed or you're not employed as a woman. 0.6 or 0.4, right? Binome distribution. So let's take a look at binomial distribution on our calculators. Second vars. So we're typing in second vars. And then go to B, which is binomial CDF. Remember, CDF is greater than or less than. And if I hit enter, this is what I get. So the number of trials is 20. The probability is 0.6. So change your probability to 0.60. The X value is 5 or less. Remember, when you're dealing with X, with the TI-84, it's always less than or equal to. If it's greater than, then you have to do 1 minus. So I have that. I hit enter. I hit enter. And then it shows up like this. And then hit enter one more time. And you get the answer. And my answer on my calculator is 0.00161152. I'm sure we're going to go to 4 decimal places. So that's what I got. Now, if they wanted 3 decimal places, you'd go here, look to the right, 5 or more, it would be 0.002. So it depends on what they're asking for, 4 decimal places, 3 decimal places. Okay. Next problem. Number 22A, we're doing a normal distribution now on the calculator. So normal distribution, we're dealing with a normal curve. Use the standard normal distribution, TI-84, to find the specific cumulative area. Sorry, still can't fix this. specified between 1.5 and 2.5. So, remember on a normal curve, the z value of 0 is right here. Z equals 0 is dead center, is our mean. So, when we're looking for 1.5 to 2.5, we're looking for the area between 1.5. Here's 1.5 and here's 2.5 on a normal curve. Right, one standard deviation, 1.5 is 1.5 standard deviation away from the mean. So we want to find the area between 1.5 and 2.5. That's what this asks for. So we're going to our calculator, second vars, which is that distribution. Second vars, once again, vars is right there. So we're going to second and then vars. And if you look, number 2 is normal CDF. And we're always going to use normal CDF when we're dealing with the normal curve. Normal CDF. Hit enter. So second vars, normal CDF, which is number 2. And then it asks for a lower limit and an upper limit. Well, our lower limit is our lower limit is the limit to the left, which is 1.5. Our upper limit is 2.5. So lower limit, you're going to type in 1.5. Upper limit, you're going to type in 2.5. Your mean is going to stay 0 and your standard deviation is going to stay 1 when we're typing in z values. So your mean is always going to be zero and your standard deviation is one. When we're talking about z values, if we're talking about actual numbers, then we would fill in a mean and standard deviation. But when we're talking about z values, we do this. So we want to find the probability between 1.5 and 2.5. We hit enter, enter, and it's going to say paste, enter. And it gives us an answer, 0.06059, 0.06059, 0.06059. And normally, when we deal with normal curves, we round to four decimal places. So look to the right when a probability, 0.0606. So the area between 1.5 and 2.5 is about 6% of the graph. All right, let's go on to this next part, 22b. Here's the normal curve once again. And it says the area to the right of 2. Here's 0, positive 2 is right here. To the right of 2. So we want to find out all of this area. So our lower limit is going to be 2 when we plug this in, but our upper limit, and we're talking about standard deviations. So remember, one standard deviation is 68% of our graph, two standard deviations, 95% of our graph, three standard deviations, 99.7, almost all our graph. So you really only have to put 5 or something. I usually put 99 standard deviations. So my lower limit is going to be 2. My upper limit is going to be 99, and it's going to give us the area between this. So we go to second vars once again, normal CDF. Same as last time, second vars, normal CDF. Hit enter, and my lower limit, lower is going to be 2. My upper is going to be something less crazy, 99. That's an upper, not a mean. 299. And if you notice, that's what I typed in, 2 and 99. Mean and standard deviation are going to be stay 0 and 1. And I get 0.0227. So that area is 0.02275, rounded to 4 decimal places, 0.0228. Alrighty. Is there? Oh, I guess that was it. There was just an A and a B. There was no C. Number 23, use a standard normal distribution table. It says use the table. Use your calculator and pick the closest one. I recommend using the calculator always. To find the area that lies to the left of 0.37. So here's a normal curve. Remember, our average is zero. So we want to find 0.37. So here it's to the right, a positive number, 0.37. So we want to find the normal curve that lies to the left. Left is all of this. And at zero, remember, that's half of our graph when it's zero. So I know my answer is going to be more than 50% because 0.37 is on the right-hand side. So my lower limit is going to be negative 99 this time. On the left of zero is negative numbers. So my lower limit is going to be negative 99. My upper limit is 0.37, and this is going to be my lower limit. So I'm using the same thing, second vars, normal CDF, lower limit will be negative 99, my upper limit will be 0.37, hit enter, 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 And remember, since it's to the, our 0.37 is to the right of 0.5, you know, our mean is 0, we know more than half of our graph is, our answer is going to be more than 0.5, more than half of our graph. And my answer for this one is 0.64430, and there's my answer. Now, if the instructions sometimes tell you to type in negative 10,000 or something, you don't have to. Negative 99 is more, when we're talking about standard deviations, is more than what you need. 24, survey indicates that a trip a supermarket shopper tends, spends an average of, so we use an average, a mean, of 45 minutes. Standard deviation is 12 minutes. The length of time spent in a store normally distributed, so we have a normal distribution here. Find the probability the shopper will be in the store more than 39 minutes. So remember, the average was 45 minutes. So more than 39 minutes. 39 minutes would be over on this side, right? Because if that's 45, 39 would be on the left. So we want to know the probability of more than 39. All of this. More than 39. Since, I mean, there's two ways of going about this. If you, we have this great calculator, we can do this. I'm going to do it both ways. Our lower limit would now be 39. Our lower limit would now be 39. Our upper limit, since we're not using z values, I'm going to say my upper limit, then I'm, you could say 100,000, you know, or 10,000 is more than enough since our mean is 45. If you think of how many standard deviations that is, that's plenty. So our lower limit is 39, our upper limit is 10,000, and we're good to go. So let's try to do that on a calculator. Second distribution, normal CDF, just like we've been doing. Our lower limit is 39. Our upper limit is 10,000. You can put as many zeros as you want. I even put 100,000, an extra zero in there. Now, we're not using Z values. You see our mean, we could say that's a zero, but we're not using Z values. So our mean is now 45, and our standard deviation is 12 from the information. So do you see how I typed that in different? I typed in the actual numbers, 39, my upper limit will be, you know, infinity, I put 100,000, my mean is 45, and standard deviation is 12. Type this in, hit enter, enter, enter. And just like we suspect, it's going to be more than 50% because it's to the left of mean and counting all of that, 0.6914. There's our answer. Now, there's another way of doing this. There's another way of doing this. We can call this mean a z value of 0, right? We can call that mean a z value of 0. So then we have to find this z value, 39. Well, we can use the formula z equals x minus the mean over standard deviation. So to find the z value, x is 39. The mean was 45 and standard deviation was 12. So 39 minus 45, hit enter, and I get a negative 6 divided by 12, and I get a z value of negative 0.5. So we can call this lower limit negative 0.5, the z value of negative 0.5. And then our upper limit, we can call 99. So we can use the z values. These are the z values. These other values we had were the given values. So if I change the values that we had to z, so I could do lower limit 0.5. So let me go back to second VARs, normal CDF. Lower limit is now negative 0.5. Upper limit is now 99. And my mean is going to be 0 because we're dealing with z values now, 0, and my standard deviation is 1. So I'm typing it in this way this time. I hit enter, enter, and I get 0.69146. Same answer as we got last time. Same answer as we got last time. Okay, so you can either do it, since these calculators, these new TI-84s, let you type in the actual numbers now rather than just the Z values. If you have an older TI-84, go get a new one. You should have got a new one at the very beginning. from the math office. Usually when you tell them you're in stats class, they give you the correct calculator, the more advanced calculator. All right, so that was 24. 25. So here it says the mean room and board expense for a four-year college. The mean room is $75.40. Let me change my color. You randomly select 9 colleges. So N equals 9 colleges. 9 four-year colleges. What's the probability that the mean room and board is less than 7,800? Now, they're asking for the probability that the mean room and board. So before they just said the probability is less than. They didn't say the mean probability is less than or greater than. We have to use a special formula. This assume that the board expense is normally distributed with standard deviation. Standard deviation is 12. So once again, we have a normal distribution. Should be a little bit better. Our mean is 7,540. We want to know what percent is less than 7,800. That's 7,800. So we have to find the Z value for 7,800. We have to find the Z value for 7,800. For that would be our upper limit. Our lower limit would be down here, negative 99. We're talking about Z values. Now, we can't type these numbers in. We cannot type these numbers into our calculator. There's a way of doing it, but we can't type these in. I want to show you why. The formula we use for this one to find the Z value is different from the last one. The last one looked like this. Right? The last one looked like this. However, this one looks like this. Since N is less than 30, or less than a large amount, and we're asking for the mean, find the mean probability that it's less than. So when they talk about the mean probability, you have to use this formula to find the Z value. So let's plug these numbers in. 7,800 minus the average, which is 7,540. 7,540. Let me see if I can be a little bit neater than this. So Z equals 7,800 minus 7,540 divided by standard deviation is 1245 over the square root of 9. Now, you need to type in the top in parentheses and the bottom in parentheses. So let's type the Z value all in. Top in parentheses, 7,800 minus 7,540, close parentheses, divided by parentheses, 1245, divided by the square root of 9. And I'm going to go outside the square root and close the parentheses. So I typed it in kind of like this. If you can see, it's kind of hard to see the whole thing. And when you hit enter, your Z value, our Z value is 0.6265. 0.6265. Now I can type this in normal CDF. Lower limit is -99 and the upper limit is 0.62 and get my answer. Second VARS, normal CDF, lower limit is -99. Lower limit is to the whatever's to the far left. The upper limit is 0.6765. Mean is 0, standard deviation is 1, and hit enter, 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 and I get 0.7506. That's different from the answer key. It's a little different from the answer key, so I wonder what if I typed anything in wrong. 7540, 7800, 78 minus 7540, 1245, and square root of 9. Yeah, it's a little off, so I'm not sure if the answer key is wrong or my work is wrong. But we're kind of close to what they had. 70. The answer key says 0.7357. I got 0.7506. Okay. Next question, 26. So here we're going to do a what we're going to do. Let's see what it's asking us to do. Calcium, most body calcium is stored. The recommended adequate intake is 1,000 milligrams. A simple random sampling. So we have N equals 18. Below poverty level, estimate the mean calcium intake for all adults with incomes below poverty level with a 95% confidence interval. So we're doing a confidence interval. Confidence interval, you have a lower level and an upper level. So there's two numbers here in a confidence interval, a lower level and an upper level. We are dealing with a 99% confidence interval. Our population, standard deviation is 188. The only thing we need is our mean. If you look, is our mean. Okay, so we're going to do a confidence interval on our calculator. So we haven't done one yet. But before I do that, let's take a look. Let's take a look at where the confidence interval is on the TI-84. I want you to click on the stat button first. You see in the upper right-hand corner right there, stat button. Go to tests, stat, and then move your cursor to the right and go to tests. And then number 7 gives you the Z interval. Number 7 gives you the Z interval. Enter. And if you look, it's asking, we need all these things. We need standard deviation. We have that. We need, see, it should look like this. We need standard deviation. We need X-bar, the average. We need N. We need the confidence level, the C level, confidence level. And that's it. So the only thing we don't have is our sample average. Here's our sample. So we need a sample average from this. So in order to do a sample average, I need to type all this data into list number one. Remember how to do list number one? Go to stat, click on stat, and then number one, edit. I'm going to go to list number one. I move my cursor up and then just hit clear, hit enter, and my list clears. And so I'm going to type in all this data, 886, 633, 943, 847, 934, 841, 115, I don't know, well, 1193, sorry, 1193, 820, 774, 834, 1050, 1058, 1192, 975, 1313, 872, 1079, and 809. Now, if I typed in the data correctly, you can go to stat, calculate, number one, var. Don't forget to turn your list two off. Let's try that again. Stat, calculate, one var, right? One var gives us the mean. List one should be L1. And frequency list, we're not using list two, so clear that. So there should be nothing in list two. Hit enter. And it gives us our X bar of 947.388. So our X bar ends up being 947.388. Well, so that's all we need. We have everything we need for this now. Let's go back to stat. So let's go back and do this right here. And I'm going to show you that you don't actually have to look at that. Let's go to stat first. Tests. And then go to Z interval number 7. And I'm going to scroll over to data. So I put my arrow in data, not stats. I'm going to hit enter. Hit enter. And my standard deviation we wrote down was 188. Standard deviation for population was 188. List one is where all our data is. Our level of confidence, our level of confidence is 95%, 0.95. Frequency, I'm sorry. Our frequency, N is 18. Don't forget, our N was 18 for this data. I'm not sure why my frequency list is not typing in 18. Let's type it in YP. What? 88 frequency. Something is wrong. Oh, maybe I'm supposed to be typing in something different. 1. Oh, free. That should just be clear. Frequency. That's list two. We're not using list two. So if I hit enter now, I put frequency one. Hit enter. I don't like my answer. So I'm going back now. I'm sorry. I'm going back. Stat again. Test 7Z interval. And then I'm going to stats. So now that I went back, I think we're gonna have everything here now. So now if I go back to stats, and do you see my standard deviation is 188, and it transferred the mean over to here, 947.38, and is 18 and 0.95. So I'm in stats. So that's where we should go. I think if we hit data, it transfers the mean over to here, like it did. And then if I hit go all the way down and hit calculate, it's going to give me the right answer. Second, stat test Z interval. And there's the answer I get. 860 point. By the way, that's the same answer as I got last time. And I'm almost 100% sure the answer in the answer key is wrong. This is correct. 860.54. So I get 860.54, and I get 1034. So I think that previous one that I answered question that I said was wrong. I must have typed in something wrong because there's only one on the answer key that was wrong, and I think that was number 26. So that's what I ended up getting. That's my confidence interval for this. So to remember the confidence interval is right here. The only thing we had to transfer over was our mean. We had to calculate our mean for this. Sorry about the confusion there. Okay, going to the next problem, 27. An instructor in Arizona State asks a random sample of 8. So n is 8. Do-do-do-do-do. Hours over 2 weeks, test the results, compute the least square regression equation. So we want the least square regression equation. So we're going to put this into list one and this into list two, okay? Compute the least square regression equation by predicting scores are the y-axis and the hours studied on the x-axis. So x-axis is always list one. So we're going to type it in exactly as we did. List one and list two. Go to stat, edit. So to type in list one and list two, don't forget, hit stat, edit. And you're going to go back up to list one and type in that data, 10, 15, 12, 20, and 8. And list 2, 92, 81, 84, 74, and 85. So there's our I'm showing you, you can't see. So there's our two lists that we have. And it says compute the least square regression line equation. Okay, so to do the least square regression line equation, we're going to go to least square regression line equation. We're going to go, and we've already did this once, but we did the R value for this stat, then arrow over to calculate. Maybe I should put calculate here. Stat calculate, right? You go to stat calculate, and then go down to number four. Number four is linear regression. And you're going to type in list one and list two. List one is L1, X is in L1, Y is in L2. And scroll all the way down to calculate and hit enter. And it gives you your equation. See, it tells you here, let me show you what it says. This is what it says. It says y equals ax plus b. It's a linear equation. And then it says a equals negative 1.19x plus b is 98.7. So in your here, look at a, and you're going to plug a into the a spot, and then look at b, you're going to plug b, 98.7, into the b spot of the actual equation. So this is the linear regression equation that it creates. That's the linear regression equation that it creates. Now, previously, they asked for the correlation coefficient. Remember, they asked, we did a problem similar where we went to the same spot. They asked for correlation coefficient, but there's nothing down here. You have to go to second catalog. So we did this already, and scroll all the way down to diagnostics on. So second catalog, the catalog button is the one right above the zero. So second catalog, then scroll down to diagnostic on. See the diagnostic on, and then hit enter, and it's going to say enter, and it's going to say done. Now if you do the same thing, stat, calculate, number four, linear regression with all the lists in there, it gives you the R value. Correlation coefficient also. R is 0.865. So it not only gives you the equation A and B that you plug into the actual equation, but it gives you the R also. Remember, you have to have your diagnostics on for that. All right, question. The last three, I think, you're gonna like these last three. Question 28. Question 28, it says, write the claim. So the only thing we're going to be writing is what HO and H1 is. And there's only three possibilities, by the way. You can write, there's only three possibilities. The mean or P, whatever value you're looking for, X equals a number and X does not equal a number, or X equals a number, X is greater than a number, X equals a number, X is less than a number. So there's only three possibilities you can write down. It says, write the hypothesis, alternate hypothesis, and identify which is it. A school publicizes that the proportion that P of its students who are involved in at least one extracurricular activity is. So P is 61%. So they're not saying less than or greater than a certain percentage. It is 61, so alternative has to be not equal to 61. Now, why don't you put greater than or less than? Because they don't tell you. They don't tell you that. You have to write one of these three, and for this one, it was that one. I'll show you the next one. Hopefully these examples will make more sense as we're going on. You see here, once again, we're going to write the HO, the null hypothesis, and the alternative hypothesis. It says, a car dealership announces that the mean time for an oil change is less than 15 minutes. X is less than 15 minutes. So you can't put this in HO. HO, if you remember the three rules I had, HO always has to be X equals. So the alternative hypothesis, what they're trying to prove is that X is less than 15. That's it. That's all you needed. And we have one more. HO and our H1. It says a company advertised that the mean life of furnace is more than 18 years old. So the mean is more than 18. So we know this equals 18, HO always equals, and we are done. So there's only three possibilities this book allows us to use, and that's it. That is the test review. I hope this video helps. I do know it's very long, close to the total review is 2 hours long. It's definitely, if you watch this whole thing, you've taken your time, you've taken some good notes. But if you do this review, and you understand each question and how to get each question and what to do now that I've showed you, you should do really well on the final exam. You guys have a great week, and let me know if you need anything.